All right, thank you for coming tonight. I'm Ron Kincaid, the lead pastor here at Portland Community Church. We have over here, we have Marko, Balogh. He's a student at Portland State University. We have Bernie Dehler, and this is Damon Doelger. He's our moderator. So Marko and Bernie are our atheists, and then this is Bart Rask, a orthopedic surgeon. And we are the Christian side. Bernie asked me, why are you doing this? And churches always talk about reaching people that don't believe the same as we do. And so the idea was, why don't we invite two that don't believe the same we do, and we have an honest conversation together. So that's what we're going to do. And back and forth, I think this will be a hostile sort of deal. We don't expect it to be that way at all. Take it away.
5 minutes, Bernie.
Okay, next slide. Next, okay, there we go. A little bit of the introduction about who I am. I want to say that if you're a Christian and you feel a personal relationship with Jesus, I was there. And my goal tonight is to let you know there's a way out if you want to get out and why you should get out. So basically, I was raised as a Roman Catholic. During the middle school years, I think it was, I was confirmed as a Roman Catholic through college. In college, I met a born-again Christian. I became a born-again evangelical Christian. You're probably familiar with the Four Spiritual Laws book by Campus Crusade for Christ. I memorized that and like to preach the gospel to people. And since I got a bachelor's degree in electronics, I've been working in the computer industry. While I was doing that, I was learning more about evangelism and apologetics. So for 25 years, I was growing in the faith, even started a nonprofit 501c3 ministry to preach the gospel on TV and the internet, working part-time on a master's in ministry degree and got that. So in 2007, I got my degree, and in 2009, I became an atheist because I found that the atheists have better arguments. And I'm now active in atheist groups and secular groups such as Portland or Sunday Assembly Portland and Center for Philosophical Naturalism is a group that I run to help people discuss and talk about how to live a life in a naturalistic worldview. Next slide. So what's the best evidence for God? I think it's unspoken, and that is that you feel this personal relationship with God. Next slide. There's a story, for example, that goes on the internet where basically a person is eating an apple and they ask the other person, the Christian asks the atheist or the non-believer. It's a complicated story, but I'm just going to summarize it and change it a little bit. The Christian asks the non-believer, hey, tell me, that apple I ate, was it sweet or sour? And he goes, I haven't tasted your apple, I don't know. And he says, neither, sir, have you tasted my Jesus. And, you know, it says, have you tasted Jesus? Have you, you know, do you have a personal relationship with him? So that's supposed to be a compelling argument. So this is what I'm going to be talking about tonight. Next slide. So William Lane Craig, he's one of the preeminent Christian debaters. He's got a philosophy degree and debates all the famous atheists. And this is, I'm going to give a couple quotes from him. One is, he basically says that if there's a conflict that arises between the witness of the Holy Spirit, which is the feelings you get about being, you know, from the Holy Spirit, and your beliefs based on argument and evidence, then it must be the former which must take precedence over the latter. In other words, you have to take precedence on your feelings over evidence. And so, next slide. Another thing he says is that it's the self-authenticating witness of the Holy Spirit that gives us the fundamental knowledge of Christianity's truth. The only role left for argument and evidence to play is a subsidiary role. In other words, primarily, your truth is derived by the witness of the Holy Spirit. In other words, your feeling that you have with God. And the evidence and all that, he says that's just secondary. That's just what I use to, you know, talk about God to non-believers, but that's not my primary thing. Next slide. So after I left the faith, I learned more about logical thinking and philosophy, and one of these is called logical fallacies, and there's a whole bunch of logical fallacies. These explain how your logic goes off the rail and can lead you to false conclusions. Next slide. One of them is called the appeal to emotion, and basically it says the problem here is when emotion is used as a logical argument, and what I want to say is that's what I think this is a form of, I think it's a logical fallacy to say follow your feelings, because your feelings cannot determine truth. Next slide. One example that is really clear is we all know probably here, none of us are Mormons probably, we all know Joseph Smith was a false prophet. We all know the Book of Mormon is, you know, nothing but fiction. We all know that. And yet they say if you pray to God, this is how you know the Book of Mormon is true. Pray to God and he'll give you a burning in the bosom if it's true. I met with Mormons a while back. How many? Okay. I did this. I got the burning in the bosom. And I was a Mormon for like 3 seconds because I realized it was not true. I mean, logically.
Okay, let's go to the very end. Next slide. Next slide. Next slide. And I just want to say that this is Ryan Bell. He's one of these pastors that left the faith. And he says, I want to have a personal relationship with reality instead of a personal relationship with Jesus.
So I'll leave it with that. And hopefully we're all on the same page. We all want to seek truth. And that's our common ground.
Okay, so 3 minutes response from the Christian Center.
One problem I have with your argument, you mentioned that the Christian faith is based mostly on feelings. My belief is the Christian faith is mostly based on historical record, and you ignore that. There is the biblical historical record documented by people that were there, and then we believe them. I believe the Bible is analogous to reading the history of the United States, the history of ancient Rome, and so forth. There are talks about feelings, talks about how Christ is in your heart and so forth. But the existence of Christ, the existence of God, is based on the historical record. People saw Jesus, many were there and witnessed him. And we believe them. Now you can just dismiss it. And that's true, but it's hard. And it's easy to dismiss historical record because you can't do an experiment to show that it occurred. But all of history is based on believing the witnesses were there. Pretty much all of it. Knowing the history of the Holocaust is often denied, and people often just dismiss the witnesses that were there. And I believe that atheism is analogous. People just dismiss the witnesses that document it. And so I think you talked about logical fallacies. One of your logical fallacies was the straw man fallacy. You talk about that it's based on feelings. Well, it's not based on feelings. That's the straw man that I'm referring to. I think it's based on historical record.
Any more you have spare time on?
Well, I would add to that. Most of us read Aristotle, Plato, Socrates, and we assume that what they wrote, they actually said. And we assume that's true. But then often when they turn to the Bible, then that's dismissed rather quickly as not being true. But the Bible is the best bibliographic, the evidence for the Bible is stronger than any other ancient document. We have thousands and thousands of documents, full documents of the New Testament books and Old Testament books, and so very well. So then you have to say, then if it's true, and if we believe history, then because it's well documented, we have little reason to believe it's not true. If we believe the history of the Bible like we would any other writing in history.
Okay. What was that last sentence again?
Said the very last sentence or two you said.
There's no more reason to discount the Bible as being historically accurate than you would for, you know, Napoleon or Civil War or anything else.
Okay, so back to your guys' side for 2 minutes and whomever would like to respond.
Okay, I think we agreed beforehand, just between us, that I'll respond to my presentation and he'll respond to his presentation. Okay, Bart said that I said it was based mostly on feelings. I did not say the evidence, the evidence for God is based mostly on feelings. I said it was unspoken. This is an unspoken thing. And I said William Lane Craig said this is the primary reason that he says is for faith and knowledge of the faith. I know there's lots of other reasons that people give, and evidence could be one. But I'm addressing one which I think personally is the one that most Christians use.
And I don't think this is a straw man at all, because like I said, I gave a couple quotes from William Lane Craig, so if you think it's a straw man, you're going to have to try to explain to me why I'm taking that out of context, because I've listened to him also, and I'm sure that's what he said and that's what he meant. The thing about Bart said there's historical records. There are no historical records for Jesus, none whatsoever. There's the Gospels. Those are not historical records. Bart Ehrman is a Bible teacher, and he says that, and I don't think the scholars disagree with this, that they are anonymously written. Of course, the church says this is written by Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, but the scholars admit they don't know who wrote this. Okay, so, and the Apostle Paul has some of the earliest stuff too, but he never even knew Jesus when Jesus was doing his ministry.
30 seconds.
Okay, and as far as Socrates never claimed to be God. You can take what Socrates is said to have, you can analyze what he has to say or whatever, but when it comes to Jesus, they're saying, you accept Jesus or you're going to go to hell. You're lost. I mean, the stakes are so high. There's a very common saying, extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence, and there's no extraordinary evidence or evidence at all for Jesus and the claims that would be made about him.
Thank you, buddy. All right, so one more minute back to the Christian side for a response.
Well, there's no historian, as far as I know, that doesn't believe that Jesus lived. He was a historical character, and the primary documents that record about Jesus are the four Gospels. The Gospels claim that Jesus rose from the dead, that they had over 500 people saw him at one time, there was an empty tomb. No one could discount that the tomb was empty. And, based on that, you have very good evidence that he really was the Son of God, and we can believe. You messed me up, man. I was rolling.
You get 10 extra seconds. Keep going.
To say there are no historical records, I'm blown away. Bernie, they're the best historical records we have of any historical document in history.
Okay, guys, we're going to have to leave that one there.
You get to come back.
No, but on this time, you get to finish.
Well,
on the next one. You guys will finish up this on the second one, because the Christians, we'll start with this question, which is why I believe in God. The theme is very similar. So I believe if the schedule is right here that Bart will take position one, and it's 5 minutes.
All right. So my background, orthopedic surgeon. I'm also a reviewer for a medical journal where I can know how to differentiate pseudo from real science. Next slide. My information is based on 3 years of research reading, actually over 500 references, all in the scientific literature of evolution. Next. There are two types of truths. We touched upon historical truths, and there's also scientific truths. Evolution is claimed to be a science. Sciences require evolution, require empiric evidence and testability. Next. There are two types of evolution. One evolution exists, microevolution. Now, one argument evolutionists have is that there's no difference between the micro and the macro. It's the creationist red herring. But in my research, I was actually able to differentiate a clear boundary between the real microevolution and the unreal macro. And this is based on my review of over 500 references. Microevolution is essentially when one creature changes to a different creature, but there's no change in the difference of parts. The parts, you might have a longer leg, a longer nose, different color, but there are no new functioning parts. Next slide. Macroevolution involves an increase in complexity. One creature over many generations grows a liver or a kidney or a frontal lobe of its brain. New parts that function, that type of evolution has no documentation. Next. Also, a difference between micro and the macro is the difference to develop reproductive isolation. We know you and your cousins have a common ancestry through your grandparents. We know you have a common ancestry because your grandparents could mate with each other. in microevolution, the offspring can mate with each other. Sometimes there's difficulty, but if you bypass certain barriers such as geographic or social, such as test tube or artificial insemination, you can get microevolution-produced creatures to mate with each other. Macroevolution involves the belief that you can get offspring of two populations that have absolutely no ability to mate with each other, such as man and chimp. It's been artificial insemination has been tried between the two, and there's absolutely no ability to mate. Evolutionists believe the common ancestor could mate, but that phenomenon of mating ability evolving into two populations which cannot mate also has never been documented. Next slide. Evolution is not a science because there's no empiric evidence, and I've looked, and it's not testable because you can't test something that purportedly occurs over millions and billions of years. Next. Evolutionists argue that it is testable. You can test it for look because you can look for outcomes that it predicts, such as the fossil record. Next slide. Now, it's not really testable, and I'll give you an example of real. In medicine, you can test for a drug lowering cholesterol and comparing it by placebo. So give a drug and versus a placebo, and you see the drug lowers the cholesterol. That's an outcome. Evolutionists claim the fossil record, but without observing the random mutation natural selection causing it. So this is like claiming a drug lowers cholesterol, but without observing the drug being given. Next. So high cholesterol by way of a drug causes low cholesterol. Evolutionists believe an old fossil by way of evolution causes a young fossil. But no one has ever seen the cause of the young fossil by the old fossil by evolution. So it's just exactly like saying, if you have low cholesterol, you can't assume a drug caused low cholesterol if you never saw the drug being given. Likewise, you can't assume a young fossil was derived from an old fossil if you never saw the evolution occur. Next. Another argument, what else could it be? It's the simplest answer, it's by inference. Well, conclusions that are inferred must be supported by analogous examples. Problem with evolution, there are no analogous examples. Next. A real science, analogous example, and I do orthopedic surgery, sometimes you get an infection. We can assume that infection is due to staph, not from that patient, but from prior patients, hundreds of prior patients. So we can give an antibiotic for staph, not based on this patient, but because of inference, because of many examples before. So, next slide. Excuse me. The problem with evolution, evolutionists claim, since there's micro, we can assume macro because of inference. The problem is, micro is not analogous to macro. They are qualitatively different. Micro has no change in complexity. Macro does have a change in complexity. Okay. No basis for inference.
Thank you, Bart. So, response from this side, whoever would like to take it?
Okay, and I think we also agreed beforehand we're going to split our response up, so we have like a minute and a half each, is that right?
Yeah, you can do that. That's
okay.
Fine.
Okay, then you let us know like when a minute and a half is up.
I'll do that. I'll give you a brief.
So, is it okay if I have like a little bit of a conversation with Bart? Bart, I want to ask you, how would you ever go about finding information about an event that occurred in the past? I know you mentioned that the Bible is a historical document. And I want to ask you, how is the fact that people wrote down the events that are depicted in the Bible at the time that they occurred different from the fact that something occurring in evolution could be, in a sense, written down in the fossil record, preserved over the ages, and then we can look back and it's just like reading through a historical record. You can infer which events happened.
Well, you can't infer. That's the problem. You can't infer if there are no examples upon which to basis. The fossil record cannot be assumed to be caused by evolution because no one has ever seen it occur. Remember, to make an inference, you have to back it up by previous examples that were actually seen. For example, I'll give you an example. To infer evolution, you would actually have to see evolution occur maybe in three, you have to maybe see a lizard evolve into a bird, or a cat evolve into something else, something in change of complexity. Then you can probably infer evolution occurred in all creatures. But there's not even one example. There's no basis upon which you can make the inference from evolution being caused.
I think the problem that you have here is that you're requiring perfectly analogous examples when perfectly analogous examples don't actually exist? So, like, do you really have an analogous example of somebody recording somebody coming back from the dead?
No, it's a historical truth. It's not a science. You're confusing.
But where's the difference, right?
There's a huge difference. There's a difference. The Bible doesn't claim to be a scientific truth. It's claimed to be historical truth. You can't do an experiment learning the details of General Patton's Battle of the Bulge. You can't do it. It's based on the witnesses who were there. That's historical truth. Evolution is claimed to be a scientific truth, which has different criteria. You're conflating the criteria for historical truths versus scientific truths. Scientific truths requires empirical evidence.
So are you saying that all the historical sciences, we might call them, like archaeology or astronomy, have no basis in truth whatsoever?
I don't know about those others. The subject is evolution.
I mean, you can never conduct a test in astronomy, right? But you can look out into the sky and you see different examples of stars at different points in their lifetimes. And from that, you infer the lifetime of a star.
You're off the subject. The subject is evolution. I don't know much about that.
I'm saying it's directly analogous.
I'll let Bernie say something.
Okay, how much time left?
Well, go on, and let's let the 2 minutes blend in.
I want to just make one thing clear to the audience. Bart said that evolution is not a science. And this is really a wild accusation. You may not realize how accepted evolution is as a science. Every state college teaches evolution as real science in their curriculum. Every single state university. How many state universities teach creationism as science? Zero. Okay, and Bart is up here against all these PhDs in science and saying evolution is not real science. Pastor Ron went to Fuller Seminary, and Pastor Ron, I think he can tell you, if you look in the faculty, I mean, they accept evolution too. They rail against atheistic evolution, but theistic evolution is kind of like a course. Nancy Murphy is one of the famous, isn't Nancy Murphy one of those professors there? She's kind of famous, and she's like, yeah, of course evolution is true. So the evidence is so strong, we don't have time to go into it, but I just want you to know that how wild of a statement that is.
Okay, so I'm going to give you guys, since it's going back and forth, 1 minute for your side and 1 more minute back on that side.
Okay, well, Bernie, you're doing your fallacies. You're appealing to numbers, and you're appealing to, you appeal to the person's status as evidence for your claim. Yes, I acknowledge what I say is it goes against the grain, but I have evidence, I make a rational argument. All you're doing is saying that I'm outnumbered by those who disagree with me. Well, you know, you've studied the logic. You know that's not a rational argument. You know that.
No. No, we can argue about that.
Okay, well, anyway. So it's called appeal to numbers. It's fallacy of appeal to numbers. Now, the other thing is evolution requires evidence, macroevolution. And I looked for it. I couldn't find it. That's all I have to say.
Okay, so Bernie or Marko, 1 more minute on your side, and then we'll be finished with this subject.
Maybe I'll just quickly say why I don't think that's a fallacy. There's a thing called scientific consensus. For example, if somebody says, I'll tell you how to play the tuba, I mean, I can tell you how to play the tuba. I've never played the tuba in my life. I don't know what I'm talking about. The experts can tell you how to play the tuba, and I can say they're all wrong, but you know, you should listen to the experts. There's a thing called scientific consensus, and there is scientific consensus on evolution. It's not a debate. It's not a crisis of evolution whatsoever. So it's not a logical fallacy to talk about scientific consensus when there is one. So the fallacy is actually wrong on your side.
30 seconds.
I'll just quickly say, I want to inform the audience that an implication of Bart's thesis is that all of these other historical sciences, archaeology, astronomy, and so on, that gain knowledge through the same method as evolutionary biology, and that's inductive inference, they're all considered invalid under his thesis. And fundamentally what the problem comes to is that Bart has a different definition of science than scientists do themselves. And if that's the case, it seems sort of impractical to even call it science anymore. Instead, you know, he's just forming a stricter definition of science than than what we really talk about when we mean science.
All right, let's leave it at that and move on to our third presentation, which I guess will be Marko. So 5 minutes, Marko.
Next slide. So I'm Marko. I'd like to start with just a brief introduction. I'm a sophomore at Portland State University's Honors College studying physics and philosophy. This past year, I've been leading the Freethinkers, a student group that advocates for secularism and science literacy. I was raised in a mostly secular environment. In this short presentation, I'd like to expose a few problems that I see with the concept of God. I'll be considering the Christian God in particular, although these problems should generalize well to any monotheistic God. My hopes are that in the next 5 minutes, I can provide some challenges you can think about on your own and give you a chance to explore how well your faith stands up to these problems, as well as giving you a better understanding of why some atheists don't believe in God. Let's do the next slide. So the first challenge is the problem of evil, which, stated concisely, is that the existence of an all-powerful, purely benevolent being is fundamentally incompatible with the existence of evil or suffering. And you might be thinking to yourself, the problem of evil has already been addressed, so why are we still discussing it? Well, the reality is that the responses which we have been given by the Christian apologists are simply not sufficient. Next slide. For example, many responses rely on some analogy between human relationships and the relationship between God and humanity, but these analogies consistently fail because God is categorically different from a human. We also commonly hear that evil is somehow for the greater good of us all, but these responses don't recognize that an infinite God must be capable of separating good from evil, preserving the former and destroying the latter. The most popular response to the problem of evil is that our free will is the cause of evil and suffering in the world, and God, as a matter of principle, will not infringe on our free will. However, this leaves natural evil, like the tragic earthquake in Nepal yesterday, completely unexplained. I also think that the free will response to the problem of evil is problematic for several other reasons. Consider the following question. Is preventing a choice from presenting itself in one's mind an infringement on that person's free will? If we say it is, then we're forced to admit that we ourselves don't have free will, since many choices simply do not present themselves in our minds, and nobody chooses which do. If we say that preventing a choice from presenting itself in the mind is not an infringement on free will, then God could prevent evil without infringing on free will, but he chooses not to. And this argument is even more challenging to the Christian conception of God if you apply it to the original sin, which is something that I'll let you all think about on your own time. Next slide. So the next problem that I'd like to explore concerns the creation of the universe. Next slide. So, if before creation, God was not outside of time, we can always ask the question of what happened before, and we get this peculiar conclusion that God was sitting around for an infinitely long amount of time before he suddenly decided to create the universe. The Christian apologist William Lane Craig has explored that possibility and found it to be unacceptable. We have to conclude that God is outside of time before the creation of the universe. So, something that you have to realize is that in order for the word choice to mean anything, it has to mean a progression from a state of multiple possibilities to a state of a single actuality. And this progression from one state to another is exactly what we mean by the word time. So in order for a choice to occur, there has to be time to allow this progression from one state to another. Hence, if God was outside of time before the universe was created, the creation of the universe could not have been a choice. So God himself could not have had free will when creating the universe. Next slide. And this is the problem of free creation. Time did not exist before creation, therefore creation could not have been a free choice. This invokes an avalanche of doubts about God. For instance, the idea that God is all-powerful is usually justified by explaining that a being who controlled the creation of the universe would have enough power to control anything in that universe at will. However, it seems that God did not control the creation of the universe, so it's much harder to explain why or how God would be omnipotent. Next slide. So what do we have left after these problems? We have a God who's not capable or not willing to prevent evil, a God who's finite, a God who's merely an occupant of the universe. Next slide. And what's wrong with that picture? Can't we conceive of such a God? Next slide. That's fine, but it's not what the Bible tells us about God. And without the biblical conception of God, it seems that we have no reason whatsoever to believe in such a God.
Okay, thank you, Marko. So, as before, 3 minutes from the other side.
Nice job, Marko. You state that the problem of evil is incompatible with the idea of an all-powerful and all-loving God. If there is an all-powerful God, that would also mean he's all-wise and all-knowing and infinitely more knowledgeable than us.
That's right.
And just because we can't think of a reason why God would allow a world with evil doesn't mean he can't think of a reason.
Right.
I think the, you know, many people claim that there can't be a God because there's so much evil in the world. They see injustice and wrong and insist that a good God would not allow this. But this creates a conundrum for the skeptic who does not believe in God. Human beings around the world find injustice that they find repulsive. Now, if there is no God, where do these strong moral feelings come from? Some would say they come from evolution. They were hardwired into us because they helped our ancestors survive. While the explanation may account for moral feelings, it can't account for moral obligation. What right does one person have to tell another person that what they're doing is evil or wrong if they say, well, it feels fine to me? When under naturalism, where we all evolve from molecules and there's no meaning, you know, how can one person say my moral view is right and yours is wrong? We call this a conundrum because the very basis for disbelief in God, a certainty about evil and moral obligation not to commit it, dissolves if there is no God. The ground on which you make your objection vanishes under your feet. You're assuming something that doesn't exist unless there is God. So in a sense, you're relying on God to make an argument against God. What if the presence of evil in the world actually makes the existence of God more likely? What if the fact that all of us are aware that there's evil in the world, that some things are just not right, would suggest more so that there really is a God that has put that in us, a sense of right and wrong? If the natural world is all we have, everyone knows nothing is forbidden by nature.
30 seconds.
So it's hard to believe out of a naturalist viewpoint that you can develop a problem of evil.
Okay, thank you. So back to your side, Marko, and okay. 2 minutes.
Okay, thanks, Ron. I want to point out to the audience just sort of the grander picture of Ron's reply. Basically, he was resorting to something called skeptical theism, which is just, it's saying that because God is just so much beyond us, there may be things that don't make sense to us, and we should just accept that. And please realize how unsatisfactory this answer would be if given in court or if given in a scientific debate, something like that. He's basically saying, well, I don't have an answer. It's an unsolved problem. But wait, you don't have an answer either. And so that puts us on an equal playing field. And I will quickly mention that there are ways to ground morality without God. But I think the critical, and that's a bigger topic for another debate, but I think the critical thing to notice here is that we're on an equal playing field. Neither of us, at this point, and maybe we could if we had a longer discussion, neither of us can ground morality at this point.
I think I can.
Well, that would probably take a little while, but maybe another day, Bernie. Do you want to say something?
Sure, I could share what the grounding is.
Sure.
Okay, so basically, morality isn't that difficult in my mind. It's all about morality. Okay, what is math about? Math is about numbers. What's morality about? It's about right and wrong, good and bad. So what is right and wrong, good and bad? It's all about community flourishing. Good things lead to community flourishing, and bad things are causing pain. And so you want to maximize pleasure and minimize pain. So when you have any kind of moral principle, I mean, I have three principles that try to try to sort these things out. One is reciprocity, one is individual free rights, and the other one is consequentialism. There's no God required whatsoever. So it's really not that difficult. And the Christian arguments try to make it sound like it's complicated, but it's really not.
All right. Thank you, Bernie and Marko. So once again, 1 minute from the center.
Well, I mean, what seems more logical? I guess I appeal to the audience here. If we take naturalism, that all there is nature, we evolve by chance, molecules forming. With nature, you know, there isn't right and wrong. But yet we have this grand sense, all of us, that we ought to do certain things. Certain things are right. Like compassion, we ought to be compassionate on the weak. Where does that come from with naturalism, with the survival of the fittest? I just think it's more logical to posit God as the reason for our moral feelings than naturalism.
Okay, so sounds like we're going to leave it there, and we have one final presentation.
Do we get a chance to sign
up? No, the last was what the Christian said. I'm keeping it there. So now we start again. Let's get on the Christian side. I'm assuming this is your presentation, Rob.
Okay. One reason I believe in God is because of design. The world exhibits design. Design must have a designer. So, for example, the sun is 12,000 degrees Fahrenheit. All the Earth's heat is from the sun. We're 93 million miles away, just the right distance. If the Earth's temperature was 50 degrees warmer or 50 degrees colder, all life on the planet would cease to exist. Why is the sun 12,000 degrees? Why isn't it 120 or 120,000? Why was the Earth fixed at just the right distance so we could have a pleasant 70 degree temperature? Why not twice as far? Because all life would cease to exist. Is this by chance? Or by design? I mean, what do you think? Which seems more logical? Let's consider rotation. The planet rotates 365 times each year as it passes around the sun. Suppose it rotated 36 times. Well, then half the world would be 10 times hotter, and half the world would be 10 times colder. And soon all life would cease to exist. Is this rotation by chance, or more likely by design? More likely by design. Even Richard Dawkins, in his The Greatest Show on Earth, says, behind naturalism or Darwinian evolution, he says, evidently the spontaneous generation of life is a very rare event, but it must have happened once, and this is true whether you think the original spontaneous generation was a natural or supernatural event. Very interesting. He's talking about, we really don't know how it all got started. We haven't figured out that first event. Could be natural, could be supernatural. We have no evidence about what the first step in making life was. But we do know the kind of step it must have been. It must have been whatever it took to get natural selection started. Before that first step, the sorts of improvement that only natural selection can achieve were impossible. Notice that, impossible. And that means the key step was the arising, by some process yet unknown, of a self-replicating entity. So even Dawkins would say, you know what? We haven't quite figured out how it all began. The design problem is a problem. Bart, you talk about how increasing complexity indicates a need for more intelligent design. Talk about that.
So I have a slide on that. You see it up there. Anyway, so the way I rationalize this is that we all know from our experience that the more complex something is, the more intelligence is required to make it. For example, if you see just random chaos, a storm probably caused it, or a wild kid or something, it doesn't take any intelligence to destroy something or make it chaotic. Increase that to a bird's nest or a beehive, something a little complexity, takes a little bit of intelligence like birds and bees. increase the complexity to maybe a mouse trap. If that's the best you can do, you're probably a low intelligent human if the best you can do is a mouse trap. Make that even more computer, an ever more complex thing. You have to have high intelligence to create that. And then the cell, ever more complex, highest intelligence, we call God. So you look through your observations, there is an exact correlation between complexity and intelligence. That's how I rationalize it.
You guys are finished on this one? Okay. So Bernie and Marko. All right, so 3 minutes, are you guys dividing it up? Yeah.
Ron, thanks. I just have a few questions for you. You know, I see this evidence of design that you're talking about in the world, but I also see quite a bit of evidence of really poor design. I'll give you a few examples of this. For example, humans are the only mammals that can't swallow and breathe at the same time. And this leads to a certain number of people dying every year from choking, okay? Another thing about humans and a few of our primate cousins, we're among very, very few animals that cannot synthesize vitamin C. And it seems to make no sense whatsoever why a designer would make us like that. You know, also something that comes to mind is we have an instinct to drink seawater when we're dying of thirst. And this will actually dehydrate you. And it would be pretty easy if you're a designer to build in a sense of the salt content of water and make that not something that you instinctually want to do. Because it actually dehydrates you and it actually makes you more likely to die. And sort of similarly along those lines, why not have noses that can smell something like carbon monoxide, right? And you can make the case, well, that's because humans produce carbon monoxide with our modern technology. But you have poisonous gases coming out of volcanoes and things. You have, for example, in a valley in Africa, an enormous amount of dissolved carbon dioxide came out of a lake one morning and effectively suffocated about 1,000 people. Why not have a sense of something like carbon dioxide concentration if you're going to design a being?
So, sorry.
Okay, I guess that was a rhetorical question. So, one of the things that Pastor Ron said was that life here, look at Earth, you have the right spin and all that. One thing you have to really be careful about is there is so much we don't know, and you shouldn't pretend to know things you don't know. We don't know what life is like outside our solar system if there is life. For example, I mean, consider that there's like a couple hundred billion stars in our galaxy, our Milky Way galaxy. Every star, you know, could potentially have a planetary system around it. So just think if one in a billion had a planetary system, there's a couple hundred right there.
30 seconds.
And then there's a couple hundred billion galaxies. So the odds of life somewhere else are very possible. It's just that it's so far away. I mean, the diameter of the Milky Way galaxy is over 100,000 light years, I think, and that's just our little galaxy. The other thing I wanted to talk about is, Dawkins said it was a rare event that life could spontaneously erupt. It's not fair to say it's rare, or, I mean, it could be common. We don't know. We don't know because we don't know how it happened, and if you don't know how it happened, you can't calculate it. And the same probabilities is math. It's statistics. You cannot calculate it if you don't know how it happened. So it's inaccurate to say it's rare or common, either way.
Okay. Thank you, guys. And another 2 minutes from this side in response.
Well, Marko was talking about all the imperfections in life. And essentially, it sounds like what you're saying is since life isn't perfect, it must not have been designed. Well, I say it's designed because it's complex and there's interacting parts. You could have a computer crash, but you know an engineer made the computer. The computer is not perfect. So imperfection does not equate lack of design. It equates an imperfect design. That's my counter.
Any more to add to it, Ron?
You know, I just, again, if I were choosing between did this universe come about by chance, mutations, molecules randomly coming together? Is that the best explanation? Or there's a designer behind this, all this amazing stuff. I was out, my son and wife and I were had a fire last night. We're looking at the moon and the beauty all around us. And I think it's more logical to say there's a designer than to say it happened by chance.
Okay, thank you guys. So you get your 1 minute to summarize the end of this one. So
everybody gets 1 minute?
You guys get
1 minute. Okay, I'll be quick. So 30 seconds.
Okay, so we heard from Ron that it seems more plausible that everything had a designer. And we heard from Bart that imperfections in the design of us, for example, is only evidence of an imperfect design. And it's not evidence that something was not designed at all. But, I have to ask Bart, if you had an all-powerful, all-knowing God, would you expect to have imperfect designs, or would you expect to have perfect designs, which seems more likely? And it's not a prediction of the God hypothesis, we might call it, that you would see imperfect designs.
Okay, and I would like to say that from my experience, all the arguments and evidences for the existence of God are logical fallacies of one sort or another. In other words, there's faulty reasoning going on, and the design argument is faulty reasoning. I think all the arguments we've heard here are faulty reasoning. And I think this is the reason why people like William Lane Craig, he knows these aren't compelling, and so he says, okay, well, really the bottom line, and I don't really say this in my debates, but the bottom line is, I know God is real because I feel him in my heart. That's why that's the last place. That's why I started off with that, because I think that's the hardest thing to look at. I mean, there's a couple books written about it. One is called Breaking the Spell by Daniel Dennett, because it really is kind of a spell. And the second one is The God Delusion, because I think it is a delusion, seeing things that aren't there and feeling things that aren't there. And I'm speaking as one who was under that delusion. And basically, I fought it and won it by logic and reason. So,
all right. So let's leave it at that, guys. Thank you all. At this point, I'd like to turn it over to the audience for questions. So I'm going to give a minute for you to ask a question. I'm going to ask first for an atheist question, and then I'm going to go to a Christian question, and then we're back to atheist. It'll go back and forth. It'll be pretty easy to figure out. So at this point, if you guys would raise your hands and then we'll bring a microphone around, can we have first a question for the atheist side of the debate?
How much time do we have to answer?
1 minute. Would it make more sense for me to give two? No, 1 second. You have 1 minute.
How
would
you get a question?
How would we answer
the side?
Question
for an atheist?
Question for an atheist?
Right here.
Yes, right here.
We decided.
Question, Bernie. Are you familiar with the book Heaven is Real?
Not sure. Is that the one that the person said he lied about?
No.
Okay.
This is another book written by a father and a son who went through a surgery. And over a period of time, a course of time, learned that the child knew things that he could not possibly have known.
Mm-hmm.
As far as I know, and people that I've spoke with, it's actually very real. And I'm just curious to know, how do you feel about something like that? Someone writing a book and them really seeing what's really happening.
Right, see, that's one of the powers of scientific thinking, is that you don't ever take one story. That's called anecdotal. And, like you can say, hey, I took this pill and I was cured of cancer. Well, maybe he was really cured because of spontaneous remission. So that's why they do tests, and you have to look at big samples and things. So, like I said, there was another story about a person who went to heaven, and they turned out, later on he confessed he lied about it. So
this is a four-year-old who knew things that there was no way that he could know.
But you have no idea how much the editors changed the story. I was in church one time as a Christian. I heard somebody share a story about this demonic activity. Later on, the pastor shared it to the congregation, and when he retold it, I thought for sure it was a different story. Then I thought, wait a minute, it's got to be the same story because some of the same details can't be another story, so similar. So I couldn't trust these secondhand stories and how they're twisted and edited and everything.
Okay. So in total, that was about it. Let's leave that question there, and move on to a question for the Christian side. So, do you have a question out there for the Christian side? In the back.
Testing. If you can understand what it would be like to have a child try to explain to you something that only adults really can understand, and if you can extrapolate from that how difficult it would be for an ant calling up your shoe to understand your love life, then you can understand how absolutely insane it is for us to think we could possibly comprehend the slightest notion of what it means to be God, much less what that God would want us to do, want us to wear, whether or not we can have sex slaves, which is in the Bible 3 times, by the way, and so forth. So how do you explain this incredibly, infinitely complex thing that just happens to be completely understandable, gives us all the answers in our tiny little human minds?
Give me 10 seconds. What's your question again?
I'm sorry.
How could we as human beings, using the brains that God gave us, possibly be so egocentric as to think we could understand the mind of something infinite?
Sure. Well, I agree with you. I mean, the difference between us and God is huge, and that's why I said earlier, the fact that there's a problem of evil, I don't see how we can extrapolate from the fact that there's evil that God can't create a world and have reasons for why there's evil. I would agree with you.
But he went on to say that this God that's so incomprehensible has all these definite things like rules about how to have sex and do's and don'ts and all this stuff. All these, it seems like they're petty things, and this is supposed to be an incredible, mind-boggling God. I think, was that part of the question? Something like that?
Okay, I guess we'll move on to the next question, which would be towards the atheist side. I'm going to hand up over here first. Orlin, you decide. Yeah, this gentleman over here by the window had his...
For the atheists, I guess my first question is, so you guys are saying basically you're 100% sure there is no God. The basis of your arguments that I felt was that you are arguing against the inadequacy of the beliefs of the other side. I would ask, what evidences you have from your side to concretely prove there is no God? You feel the shortcomings of the other side defend your case, but what is there concretely from your side to prove that you are certain there is no God?
I would answer that there's not really such a clear distinction between proving your side and disproving the exact opposite. You're basically forced to rule out alternatives in order to talk about your opinion on things. And also you asked whether we're saying that we're 100% certain that God doesn't exist. And I would say absolutely not. I would just say that it seems more likely, given the arguments that we've heard, to say that a God doesn't exist, because we can, at least what my argument was talking about, is that we can sort of chisel away all of these extra things that we see in the Christian conception of God, and we get this completely different idea of God, and yeah, that idea of God's plausible, but then we have essentially no evidence, no reason to really believe in that God. And so I'm not making any claims towards certainty. It's about evaluating all the arguments. And you can never be really certain about anything.
Okay, thank you, Marko. So back to the Christian side. Can we get another question for the Christian side? Hand over here.
Hi. I have a question for Bart. If you don't believe in evolution, what is your alternative?
Well, God.
Jesus?
Yes.
What's your alternative?
I can't think of one. I know that evolution is definitely out because there's no evidence for it, and by our observations, it's impossible. There are no human observations of anything increasing in complexity through random forces. Our observations are based, are actually show the opposite. If things are left to random, they actually increase in chaos. So my conclusion is based on observations and empirical evidence. We know that it takes a hand or some kind of designer to make things that are complex. Life is a complex interacting machine. And I know evolutionists don't like the machine analogy, but it basically is a machine. It has interacting parts, and there's and our observations are that complex interacting parts requires someone to have designed it. That's why.
Well, then, how do you think humans came to be then?
How do you think what?
How do you think humans came to be then?
Came to be. God just poof, he made them.
So you take poof, God made them rather than some scientific proof?
It's not scientific, it's based on historical record. Contrarily, there is no scientific evidence of the proposed alternative. Now, Marko said that my scientific criteria are too strict. The scientific criteria were proposed to me by an evolutionist who collaborated with me on a book, who introduced me to Karl Popper's requirements for science, testability, empirical evidence. So, but evolutionists just ignore the strict criteria that were developed during the Enlightenment. Evolution is basically a step backward from the Enlightenment. They superficially seem to follow scientific methodology, but when you really look at it, they really don't.
Okay.
So there is no alternative.
Let's leave that question there. Time is up on that one. And got time for a couple of more questions. So if you guys haven't got the pattern yet, this question would be for the atheist side.
This is for the atheists. When you said that a professor or professors all over in high school, colleges teach about evolution, then I wonder if you agree that because so many people, when they say something and do something that's wrong, that a large group, maybe countries, people, a large group, does that make it right?
Okay, so basically, again, it comes down to the experts in the field. These are people with PhDs who work on biological evolution. They're not people in America. You take a poll. Most people in America might reject evolution. It's not a poll of citizens. It's a poll of experts, people who know so much it's like speaking a different language to them.
Experts do something wrong. That they could like.
How could it... That's like saying that the people in the orchestra are experts at playing the musical instruments incorrectly. How could I dare say an orchestra is playing incorrectly when I can't even play an instrument? How audacious is that? Yeah, I would have to at least play one instrument before I can condemn them as not knowing how to play music.
I have a response to that. See, the thing with evolution is no way to check your work.
Sure.
It's not testable. There's no way to check it. In an orchestra, you can check it because the music sounds nice. But in evolution, there's no way to check if you're right.
Peer review is a way of checking.
No, it isn't. Peer review is a way of getting people's opinion. But I reviewed it, and I couldn't see any connection between the conclusion and the evidence. And I'm a medical reviewer. I do it on things where people's lives depend on.
But you're qualified to review medical journals, but you're not qualified to review articles for publication for biology.
Yes, I am. I've done it. I did it when I was an undergraduate in microbiology. I wrote some papers in microbiology, and I reviewed and I read a lot of them. I know science.
This is an atheist.
I'm sorry.
You guys,
I went off.
45 more seconds. Go ahead and respond.
Okay, so I guess basically the answer there is that this is not just a straw poll. Yeah, that would be a bandwagon fallacy if that was it. But I'm trying to say there's a thing called scientific consensus. You can look it up and learn about it. It's something special. It's important. There's a Christian organization called the ASA, American Scientific Affiliation. These are Christians who will accept evolution, and they accept other things too. And the guy there, I can't remember his name, he wrote an article about why scientific consensus is so important. It's critical that you understand what scientific consensus is and how important it is. It doesn't always happen, but when there is some consensus, it's extremely important amongst the experts. And with evolution, there's absolutely no crisis whatsoever. When they say there's a crisis in evolution, it's like lying. It's a falsehood.
Okay. Let's wrap that up. question up and move on to our, let's get a final question for the Christian side, and then we'll have a few minutes for final comments from the panel. So, we're going to back. Oh, Lynn, about right here.
Thank you. I could ask this to either side, actually. How would you explain miracles that happen, or the power of prayer, where people are healed? That, I mean, scientifically, can you prove how that happens if there's no God? Because I've had miracles happen in my own life, which is not a feeling, it is something I actually experienced.
So, but this is a question for the Christian side, is that?
Well, yeah, I'm just asking.
Well, there are many miracles recorded in the Bible, the largest being the resurrection of Jesus Christ. What do we do with that? We rely on the historical record. So the record says that hundreds of people saw Christ raised from the dead. Hundreds witnessed, you know, the tomb was empty. And based on that historical record, since we believe historical records to be true, unless they prove themselves false, we believe that those miracles actually happened.
Especially since Ron was short on that, and I think these guys really want a chance to respond. I felt like it was a question that I could answer. So, Marko, if you want to take 30 seconds.
Yeah, so I'll just really quickly say that in the case of miracles happening in your own personal life, or you hear anecdotal stories from your friends or something like that, the problem there is that you don't know if it would have happened anyways. And then you say, well, how would I go about finding that out? And what you do is you do a controlled scientific study. And there have been scientific studies done on prayer, and they've actually found that prayer has no discernible effect on the recovery rates of patients from cancer, for example. And they've actually found slight negative effects sometimes. But of course, we know that's just random variation, right? And so, the thing that I want to emphasize here is that you have to normalize for the fact that in individual cases, you can never know if it was a miracle. It may be, right? That may be the case. So what you do is you have to look at the population of data, and then you perform scientific analysis on that. And then from that, you can draw conclusions about what happens in general.
Okay. Let's wrap up the questions there.
Can I get just a quick...
Go ahead.
Very small. Okay. I just want to say just some things to consider. One is, you know, why aren't there miracles today? Well, if you turn on Christian TV, you can see Benny Hinn healing people all over the place. Hank Hanegraaff, the Bible Answer Man, says this is not real stuff, and he looked into it and says none of these are bona fide. The Catholic Church has all kinds of miracles. You got the bleeding wafer and all kinds of things. So, you know, and Peter Popoff was one guy doing miracles on TV, and he got exposed. He had an earpiece, and they were feeding him information about people and everything. So those are a lot of things that just to take in for background information when you analyze and hear claims.
Okay. So wrapping that up, we are going to have you get 2 minutes. I mean, in fact, we're going to start with the atheist side, right? So I'm going to give 2 minutes to each of you to go ahead and state your final points on the subjects. And then I'm going to give 2 minutes to each of you on this side. So, Marko, looks like you're ready to start us off.
So the first thing that I want to say is kind of observe what has happened in tonight's debate. I think that we've seen, instead of seeing one argument just sort of blow the other out of water, we've seen that both sides have really found out how little they know and how uncertain they ought to be in their conclusions. And it's, you know, for example, we talked about morality quite a bit, and it's commonly thought that naturalists have no grounding for their morality. And it's pretty commonly thought that religious people can ground their morality in God quite easily. But we see that there are problems with this. So what I really want to emphasize is that we're actually on the same, we're on the same playing field. We both have problems with these things. And we get these sort of one-sided questions, you know, to the atheist, how can you possibly know that's right or wrong? Well, you can. It turns out that you can actually ask the same question to the believer. It's just not commonly asked, and it's sort of popular opinion that the believer just says, God. Well, there's something called the Euthyphro dilemma, which says, you know, does God know what's right, or does he make things right? And it seems that if you really analyze those two options, neither of them are acceptable. And the last thing that I want to say is just how important it is that we have discussions like this. Because a person's religious beliefs, in almost every case, decide their political beliefs, right? And we're all, most of us are voting citizens, and these things really matter for the collective well-being of our society. So it's really important that we have debates like this and sort of flesh out the topics and see, get to the bottom of the matter. So I'd like to thank the church for holding this debate, and I think it's been really great. And thanks to the audience as well.
Thank you, Marko. Okay, Bernie, just a couple of minutes.
Yeah, I guess I'll start off. You know, like, Christians don't all agree on everything, and the same thing with atheists too. So, you know, some things Marko might disagree about. One thing Marko just said is that both sides have problems with morality. In my viewpoint, there is no problem with morality from a naturalistic viewpoint. It's not difficult to understand at all. And I know there's Christian objections to that, and I'm just amazed sometimes when a Christian philosopher says there's no grounding for morality for an atheist. And it's like, I don't understand how this person can have a PhD in philosophy and say that, because it's to me it seems so obvious and it's not difficult to understand whatsoever. As far as, and like I said earlier, I just want to mention too that Ron said that all scholars agree that there's a Jesus that lived. Well, even Bart Ehrman says, yeah, I think there's a Jesus that lived. But in no way does he believe this Jesus of the Bible that did these miracles and rose from the dead. He says there's probably a guy named Jesus, and they thought he was Messiah, and they crucified him. That's not the Jesus of the Bible. So don't conflate that, confuse that. Just because people said there was a Jesus doesn't mean it's a Jesus of the Bible at all. That's a huge stretch. And he said, it says in the Bible 500 people saw him at one time. Who? It doesn't list in the Bible. How convenient. The Book of Mormon also says there's all these witnesses. Well, actually, they named the witnesses in the front cover. There's 12 of them or something. But it doesn't mean anything. There's nothing you can check. So anyway, like I said at the start...
30 seconds.
Okay, I think all the arguments for God really come down to logical fallacies. And that's one thing I want to introduce to you. You can look online. There's I showed on my slide, there's a chart of them. It's called... your logical fallacy is, and it talks about like 30 of the popular ones, and there's actually hundreds of them. But it's interesting to learn about, because you can learn about what deductive reasoning is and logical fallacies, about how thinking goes astray. And I think if you learn that, it not only teaches you how to think about this topic, but any topic, because critical thinking is all about thinking correctly, and they don't teach us in school. So anyway.
Yeah, I think you're right on that point. all right, so 2 minutes for each of you guys. Ron, you're up
for it. I'll talk again about this universal sense that all people around the world have that certain things are wrong, certain things are evil. Where does that come from? You know, suppose you hear a cry for somebody that needs help. Part of you says, I don't have time to stop, I'm too busy, I'm headed somewhere. But something else in you says, I ought to help that person. Now, if you're a naturalist and all we have is nature, and we evolve from, you know, random mutations, why should I give up my meaningless molecules for somebody else and their meaningless molecules? Why should I do that? But if you believe there's a God who put that ought in our hearts, that there's a right and wrong based on Him and His nature, then it all makes perfectly sense. We seem to universally have a sense of compassion, that we ought to care for the weak and the sick. But where does that come from? I have yet to find a rationale in evolutionary naturalism, the survival of the fittest, that suggests that we ought to care for the weak and the suffering. Nature is stern. The herd advances by abandoning those who are weak, those that hinder it. I still think it makes more sense to believe that the reason we feel that there's evil in the world and right and wrong suggests, rather than suggesting there's no God, it more so suggests that there is a God.
Bernie and I agree on the need for critical thinking and logical fallacies, and that's why I concluded that evolution is a pseudoscience. And he also talked about consensus. Well, we all know that almost all scientific advances go against the consensus. I'll give you a little micro example. We all, recently in the news, it was believed that you should get a mammogram every year, and then that that was the consensus. And then later on with more studies, the consensus has changed. So consensus has changed all the time. The other thing is we have to, science, which evolution is purportedly to be, has to be based on empirical evidence, evidence which you can see and measure. All of us around us has experience that things that are complex, meaning have many interacting parts, required something to make it. Likewise, all of us have noted that things that are chaotic require no intelligence, random forces. None of us has ever seen a random force create something complex. Evolutionists claim, well, it takes millions of years and you can't observe it. Well, therein lies the fact that it can't be classified as science. You can't test it. You can't test something reportedly occurred millions of years. Marko and I had this discussion before. His counter is, well, you can't practically test it. Well, you can't practically test that there's a God either, because it requires being in a different dimension. No, we can't test that there's a God, but we can't test that something occurred over billions of years. Now, maybe if human existence occurs over billions of years, and we can document this, then I would change our mind. But the current state of science is, there is no testability of it, therefore it can't be classified as a science. It's a faith-based belief.
Okay, so that concludes, that really concludes all of that. I know, Ron, you'd like a minute to give closing remarks.
Thank you, Marko and Bernie, for coming tonight. This would be called an away game for you, coming into our house, so thank you very much for sharing with us. Thank you, Bart. And I hope we've at least come to understand each other a little better and why we believe what we believe. So, and thank you for coming to join us tonight, asking your questions. I hope you found this beneficial. So have a great night, and I'm sure some of these guys would be happy to take your questions if you want to take them up here. All right? Thanks.